Hey everyone, hopefully everybody is doing very well, and what you just heard was my take on the guitar solo in Gimme Shelter by the Rolling Stones, live in 1972. To be very specific, Mick Taylor played this particular solo in the middle of the song on the 21st of July in Philadelphia on the afternoon show. So in this video we're going to do a very detailed breakdown of this solo, and we're going to analyze all the notes against the harmony, since I've got absolutely nothing better to do than editing videos. This will hopefully help you not only how to play this solo technically, but also understand the ideas so you can implement them, or steal these ideas for your own improvisational purposes. And hopefully you will understand why I feel so passionate about this solo, why it feels so great. Now, Gimme Shelter in itself is of course a very powerful song. That song is on the Let It Bleed album. Now, the Rolling Stones happen to be in a very good live shape in the early 70s and also have their creative peak, I think. That's my humble opinion. Share a comment if you agree with this or if you think something else. It shall be no surprise that this particular era is my favorite. Of course, there are many epic live versions around there. But I feel that this solo stands out a little bit to me. Why do I feel like this? Well, somehow this solo comes across like a truly inspired improvisation. It has this great sound and feel, and it sort of has a really nice naturally flowing story. The other reason is that from this particular show there's no video footage available, there's no official audio available. There's only this unreleased Decca Live album, which is a desk recording, which is somewhat inferior sounding. It does sound and feel great though. I think it has added reverb or something, but yeah. Let's hope the tracks are still separately available, so this will get a real good remix someday. Anyway, sounding inferior or not, I used to listen to that stuff over and over when I was learning to play guitar solos. I've always felt, and I still truly feel that this era and this year perhaps, and maybe even this show, has a certain extra vibe, an extra magical vibe to it. So I figured that this guitar solo deserves a proper transcription so we can write it in stone a little bit and honor it like that, right? What do you say? Now, of course, there's this great guitar solo, but there's also very great rhythmic guitar playing from Keith Richards. I do want to state this as well. I want to encourage you to listen to this unreleased Decca Live album and listen how he plays and switches pickups through different sections of the song. And this helps to really drive the solo along and create this great buildup. I think I feel an authentic YouTube moment coming up. Hey, what's up guys? Hopefully everybody's doing very well, and I really want you to stick around to the end of the video because I'm so stoked and excited and pumped to reveal my top 3 secrets to mastering Mick Taylor's epic live guitar sound in a 1972. Now, I don't think there's any secret here. There's only craft and skill that we can learn. Now, though I knew I had the solo already by heart, I listened to this over and over again, I did end up experimenting and changing my guitar setup to help to get this sound, to get the feel. Mick Taylor did have this very special live sound in that era. I mean, you could say this is a very thick and creamy sound, but it also has a lot of bite and attitude to it. So I studied a little bit of other footage available and just see how he actually holds his guitar and how it looks, how it seems to be feeling to him. And it came across that he seems to play his guitar very lightly and very effortless. So I went and put my guitar into a little bit of a lower action, and I mean really low, to where it's only almost bus free if you only play it very softly. I mean, I usually tend to go for medium action, play tens. Mick Taylor plays nines, I believe. It already makes a big difference in how it feels. Now, with the super low action, it's pretty easy to overplay, so you have to take a little bit of time to adjust to it. I mean, I had to do that. And that way you can sort of try to get this controlled attack, and that will help to add clarity to your tone. The frets are going to help to add clarity to the tone. What can also help is play with one of these. This is a 0.73mm pick. I actually don't do that. I usually always go back to my favorite Jazz 3. I actually prefer the old text material for this, but that's something else. I think it's cool to experiment with setups, and this super low or almost too low action actually creates a different guitar. There are many players around who play like that back then and now still, and it's actually pretty cool, I think. The guitar is really relaxed, it stays really easily in tune. It does make sense on a Les Paul style guitar. The guitar I'm using is that one. You've probably already seen it on the channel a few times. It's my 1973 converted deluxe. I mean, it's a Gibson Les Paul deluxe converted to standard specs. It's loaded with a set of Gibson T-tops. Another small and important tone tip for helping with this Mick Taylor sound is rolling down the tone knob. I've actually rolled down the tone knob in the intro video to about 3-ish. And this helps to cut a little bit of the high end, but just a little bit. There's enough clarity and transient still left there. Amp-wise, for this video, nothing fancy here. I'm using my in-the-box Logic's own Ampeg modeling amp. I cannot say it absolutely nails the tone, but it does a pretty decent job. And since I'm dedicated to this mobile setup, it's what's going to work for now. This is also something that most people can just do at home with a DAW that has amp sims built in. I mean, there's probably some kind of Ampeg bass stack around. And if it at least models it to some extent where the mid-range works as an Ampeg does, then you can probably get pretty good results, I think, with the way an Ampeg mid-range works. I mean, there's this function where you go into the middle position where this with this rocker switch on the mid-circuitry. And if you really give it enough signal, it's going to create a really weird resonance around the 800 Hz mark. This creates this funny raw sound, and this is something you almost always hear in Mick Taylor's live sound of that era. Now, it's absolutely okay to also dial in a fair amount of high end as well and to make it pretty bright. And then fiddle with the mic setup and the mic angle to tame some of that iceberg attack. And of course, also matching your playing intensity, keeping your picking attack in check as well. I'm curious if there are other people around there that play with Ampeg amp style modeling amps in the box and see what the results are. I really hope to be able to soon dial in some real Ampeg tones as well with this amp, but that amp is still back there waiting for a really scary overhaul. Right, it's now time to go to the solo breakdown. I will leave a link to the solo transcription so you can follow along more easily. And there's also a link to a backing track or backing tracks. There's also a slow version available for convenient practicing. Have fun. Okay, the first line goes like this. So we have four times playing this bend while playing two strings together. We're going to try to make use of this dissonant sound you get with the flat 7 and the tonic sounding together. And of course they go out of pitch up to the major 7 to the tonic again, creating this cool distorted sound. The last time, that will be the fifth attack. We play this B string on its own. And the challenge is to make it sound very dramatic, have a very nice vibrato with a very rugged expression and also maintaining the pitch while also matching up the play intensity and keeping your pick attack a little bit in check. I probably have to tame it a little bit to make that note sound thick. Then we're going to drop this B string with a pull off here in this 9 position to this one there. Oh, by the way, the line starts on an afterbeat. It sits between the first and the second count. You could do a count in like this: 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. And it sits there. I'm gonna play it once more slowly. Right. Second line goes like this. Of course, Mick Taylor excels at having a very nice emotional expressed bending and the vibrato, of course, like in the last line. Let me play it once more slowly. You could do a count like this: 1 and 2 and 3 and. This last section goes a little bit in a shuffle feel on the record, but you can do it as you like. I think played a little bit in shuffle feel adds a little bit to the character. So you can freely try to do that. Okay, what we have here is we play our 11 to 9 in a pull-off. This is just basic 4 minor minor 3rd pentatonic. We bend our sus up to the perfect 5th. Take our 12th position B string with it, which is a flat 7. And this will also sound harmonically rich with the sound we have. Because of the nature of the flat 7, this dissonant feel. Then we take our 11th bended up G string back. With this small pull off there, it's very typical stuff. We play our 9th position G string, which is a minor 3rd, which gives this blues sound, especially with this playing intention and a vibrato. Little minor pentatonic section there. And we end with a very heavy vibrato on this 13th fret G string. Let me play the whole section again, slowly, 2 and 3 and. And here it is once more in a regular speed. Right, I will start the next line where we left off with the 13th position G string with this slight vibrato thing. So what's happening here, we make use of this dissonant quality here again. It's just the nature of this perfect 5th and flat 7 sound that creates this great dissonance with this distorted guitar tone, obviously. So we do a little bit of a fierce sliding back to this 11th position. This 9th position here is picked. This is a little pull-off section. Then we go into this legato line. I believe I hear on the record that that note is picked. You could try doing this in legato, it sounds fine, I think. But I think it's picked. These are the details. Obviously, you can also play with this 4th finger. That would be a more neat guitar technique. Guitar teacher would be happier seeing that than the 3rd finger. But I guess it's a typical vintage rock thing to play in a more diagonal fashion. To be honest, I find it easier to play with the pink. It's just a matter of being accustomed to something. I get a little bit better results with the pink, so to say. Okay. We don't really have to go over this theoretically, I think, but here it is once more slowly. Right, next line goes like this. Very nice packed little line. Let me play it again slowly. This one starts on the afterbeat of the first count, so you have your 1 and the 1 and. Between the 1 and the 2 is where this line starts. So if you would do a count in, it would sound like this. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. This is all happening over the C sharp, of course, so you could just say this is all minor pentatonic ideas. There's a lot of hammer pull action. Here's what's going on. These are picked. These are pulled. It's also very... There's a lot of legato action going on. Here's what's happening. These are picked. These are pulled. You have this little pull off there. And then pull off there. This one is picked. That's picked. Make use of our dissonant quality there of our bended up G string on the 11th position. With this 12th position B string, that's our perfect 5th and flat 7. Pull that and pick that. fierce vibrato. Let me play the whole idea again slowly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Little idea once more. Right. Okay, the next line, you could actually say this is a 4-bar line, but I will do this in two sections of two bars apart. The chord progression does change here. The chord progression is going to move from C sharp major to B major to A major for two bars. The A major is going to be two bars. So this first section will be on the C sharp and the B chord. Here's what's happening. Once more slowly. So this 11 position D string gets a pretty thick vibrato. Go from the 9th to the 11th and we play the 11th again. Slide that up to the 13th. Now the chord is going to the B chord. Now from a C sharp minor pentatonic perspective, of course this is a perfect fifth, but it's happening over the B chord. And on the B chord, this G sharp, so to say, sounds like a major six. This is a beautiful melancholic sound. So that's what you get. This is a B, which is just a tonic over B, so nothing to worry about there. Sounds a bit like a E major pentatonic idea here. This, of course, is a C sharp minor idea. Over the B, this would sound like a perfect fifth, a sus, and a nine, but that wouldn't make too much sense to think of it like that. Here's the idea once more slowly. And here's the idea once more in the regular tempo. 1, 2, 3, and. Okay, the next line is happening over the A chord. I'll play it first in a regular speed. Of course, this is all C sharp minor pentatonic ideas, but this is happening over the A chord. So what's going to happen over the A chord? Pretty beautiful, I think, sound-wise. These are pretty beautiful notes. I mean, look how this sounds harmonized. I mean, it's pretty beautiful, I think. So we have like an A major 9 and A major 7. So over A major 9, major 7, major 6, perfect fifth, and A major 3rd. Very nice stuff, I think. Now the question, of course, does arise, like, did he think like that when he executed these lines? Probably not. But it doesn't mean that we can you can take the knowledge from this and use it for our own improvisation, because these sounds are really effective. This sounds a little bit like an E major line. Over A, this gives you a major 7, a major 6, and a perfect fifth. This is happening over the C sharp chord again, so that's a tonic. Here is the whole line again. Now the next line kept me puzzling a little bit. I had to listen for it over and over again, and I think I finally have it. This is also happening over the chord progression, but here's the line. It's a bit of a weird line, I think. In his improvisation, he's a little bit stuck there and he plays pretty random stuff. And it's, of course, pretty hard to replicate such a moment. Here is how I think it goes. So yeah, there you go. So yeah, it sounds a little bit random. Here it is once more slowly. Okay, Do we have to analyze this? Let's see. Nothing so special over the C sharp. Perfect fifth. Flat seven. Then again over B. This sounds like a tonic. And has a major six again there. So yeah, that's it. Major six and perfect five over B. Somehow the major six always has this melancholic touch to it. Here it is once more. Okay, the next line is happening over the A chord, and we're going to start the line by our pickup note from the last line. One and two and three and four. All over the A chord. Again, these are the major 7 and the 9 again. So we have the same sound ideas. This will be a perfect 5th, major 6, a major 7, and a 9 again. It's pretty cool if you harmonize this, I think. I mean, I like that stuff. Here's the whole line again, once more slowly. So we hammer these, and then we play everything picked. Right, next line over the C sharp chord. I think this is my favorite line of the solo. Here is why this is my favorite. We're actually creating a chord. Sounds like that. It's a major six chord over C sharp. And here's how it goes. We pick this G string on the 11th position, bend it up on whole note. Take our flat seven on the 12th position. Then a tonic. This has a lot of nice dissonant quality. It's a minor third up there. We play our tonic and minor third with the hammer pull idea. You can choose to either pick this or do it with a legato style. I think it's picked. Gives a little bit more bite. I think I did it legato style in the intro. A very nice lush bending of the 12th string. You can take your time with this. See what happens over the B chord. This sounds like major 9 and tonic. And that sounds like major 6 and perfect 5th. Very nice in junior. Pretty beautiful. This note will land on our A chord, which is a major 6 as well. Here is the whole idea again, slowly. You might want to speed that one up. And the whole idea again. I think it's a pretty cool one. Right, the next line is going to pick up where we left off on that A chord. Here is what's happening. That sounds a little bit weird. Let me do it again. Something like that. Let me play it again slowly. So here is what's happening harmonically. We have a major 6, the perfect 5th again. Beautiful major 3rd again. And these are, yeah, the major 7 and that 9 again, if you want to analyze it like that. Harmonically, this is what you're going to hear over the chord. I think it's pretty cool. These are with hammer on. And then the next line is going to start with a picked 11 position of the G string. With all of that all of that legato stuff there. The next section is that weird super legato section. This line is happening both over the C sharp chord and the B chord. You could say you hear this as a sus and a minor third over the C sharp. And you will hear this as a perfect fifth and a sus over the B. Like that. Let me play it again with the line in front of it, so you can hear it in perspective a little bit in time. Like that. Next line, also a really cool one. Here's how it goes. You could say that over the A chord we are going to hear the major 7, the major tone, major 9, resolving into the major 3rd, and then a line like 5th, major 6, major 7, 9, major 3rd, and we're going to bend the major 3rd up, but then we're going to land on the C sharp chord. And this is a pretty cool idea. Mick Taylor might even influence a lot of players that came after him, including David Gilmour, Pink Floyd, and Steve Lukather from Toto. It's a pretty cool idea. We play our tonic for C sharp. We bend it up to the major 9, the 2nd. And on that same string, we pick that B string with a finger behind that, so you can actually get a minor 3rd as well. It's not overbending to the minor 3rd, you can also do that. But that's something else. It's a very emotional line, I think. Pretty cool. Okay, here's how the whole section goes. Slowly. On the transcription, you can see exactly which ones are picked. I didn't do this one correctly. Let's do it again. Here's the whole idea. It just starts on the first count of the bar. 1, 2, 3. Yeah. By the way, this note is going to land on the B chord. Okay, next line, pretty cool classic ideas. I'll play the C sharp on the 1, but bear in mind, this is actually played from the 4 and the after beat after the 4th count. Here is how the line goes. 1, 2, 3, 4. If we have to analyze this over a B chord, you will get pretty cool sounds again. You will hear this as a major 9 and major 6 again. Then briefly, of course, minor 3rd and tonic for C sharp over B. This will be a sus and a 9. We don't have to worry about that too much. Then, over the A chord, you could say you hear this as a major 7 and a 5th. Of course, he bends it a little bit as in a blues fashion, thinking as a C sharp minor pentatonic idea. So that wouldn't make so much sense to analyze that over A, because you will get some wrong notes there. Now, the C sharp is just your regular major 3rd for A. Pretty beautiful. So we have a major 3rd, a major 7 briefly, and then we bend our major 2nd up to the major 3rd for A. Now then, to me it's always a little bit challenging not to have a G string buzzing away in the breeze. you see. A little bit challenging, but it's a cool line. Okay, we go to the next line. This sounds a little bit wrong to some ears. It does sound wrong to my ears. I think he plays a major idea for C sharp, but it does have some kind of effect. It sounds refreshing. It sort of pulls you out of the atmosphere for a little moment. Here's how that line goes. You see, that is a wrong note because that is sounding at the moment your B chord sounds, and that will give you a major 7 over B. Now you might ask, what's wrong with a major 7? Well, the major 7 for B isn't wrong in itself, but the problem is we are playing in the key of C sharp. Our ears are tuned to the key of C sharp, and that does not include is A sharp note here. So that's gonna sound wrong. Anyway, let me play the line again slowly. Just a minor pentatonic idea over C sharp. Hammer pull. Honestly, this over B could make sense as well. It's like a sus and a major 9 over your B chord. This sus isn't too beautiful, but the major 9 is. And we land on this C sharp again, which just gives us our major 3rd. Next line, picking it up from the section before. So we increase a little bit in intensity and also increase the lengths a little bit. So you could actually keep holding on to the G string. You could also do it like that. Now, this is pulling all the way over the progression. What you're going to hear is, of course, a tonic for C sharp, a major 9 for B, and a major 3rd for A. Pretty nice idea, and of course, is a pretty easy and effective songwriting melody trick where the chord progression descends and the melody and the top note will ascend and functions from tonic to major 9 to major 3rd. Okay, here's the idea once more slowly. This is also a pretty cool cross rhythm idea. So out of that cross rhythm idea, this is a pretty cool line. The pickup is on the 4th count of the B bar. Here's how the whole line goes. A little bit challenging. I think he does it like this. Let's do it once more slowly. So he repeats those two notes on the 17th fret of the B string. And I'm not entirely sure if this is in between it. It's not too clear on the recording. You can put it in between it. If you don't, you just have to extend this note. Then it will be like this. Or. Sounds fine either way. Here's the whole line again. Once more slowly. This is happening over the A chord. Let's analyze this just a little bit for fun. It's actually pretty cool function-wise. Again, a major 3rd, perfect 5th, and the major 6th. By pre-bending this and releasing this, we get our major 6th. And you could say this is a major 3rd, perfect 5th, major 6th, and major 7th again. This is just going to be pulled off perfect 5th, major 3rd to major 9. pretty cool sounds. Okay, we're approaching the end of the solo nearly. The pickup is going to be on the fourth count of the second bar of the A chord where we are. Here's how the whole line goes. Little short section here. It's very nice to take a little bit of time with this bend to just have a good time with the release. Over the C sharp chord, the minor third is going to be bended up to the sus. So we have the tonic, the flat third, the sus, the flat third again. Nice funny little thingy with the flat third, flat seven, and a tonic. Flat seven. Okay, last but not least, this is the last line of the solo. Okay, I had to go back to the transcription for a brief moment. I saw a little mistake. That happens sometimes. Here's the last line. It starts on the B chord. Pretty nice ideas. So we have this chord bending idea again, where it's nice to take a little bit of time, make sure you hit all the notes and they sound together, so you have this dissonant quality. Now this is pulling over the chord change, so this is going to sound as a major third over A. And this major 7 again, here, major 7, major 9, major 6, and of course, that nice fierce vibrato on this note, minor 3rd for C sharp, but it sounds like a perfect 5th for A, and then we have nice hammer pull action. If you analyze this over at A, you will hear all sorts of stuff. Major third, major second, major seventh, and the major and the perfect fifth again. And then we are here on the C sharp. Here's the whole idea again. And that's all. Hopefully the explanations were clear enough to help you to learn how to play this and hopefully also understand the ideas. Hey, thank you very much for watching this and please feel free to leave a comment here below and let me know your thoughts. It was great going back to my musical roots and hopefully my passion translated to paper and also to you guys through this video. Please take care, behave, and we'll see each other soon. Have a great weekend, you all.